My name is Brian Mosley. I serve as the lead pastor here at the Springs. Everybody say, hi, Brian. Okay, I just wanted to do that. I've always wanted to do that ever since Rory has been doing that. And so today was my day. So thank you for participating with me. If you don't mind, let's do it all together one more time. Everybody say, hi, Brian. Awesome to see you guys. Thank you so much for being here. That was a lot of fun. Thank you for letting me have some fun this morning. I want to also welcome all of our guests who may be watching by way of YouTube. We're glad that you're tuning in, and we pray that God just speaks to us all in a wonderful way today. Amen. Today I want to continue a message series that we've been calling New Year, New You. But before we dive in fully to that, I want to just highlight one of the things that Rory was talking about, in that we are launching our second service on February the 2nd. And from that day on, we're going to be having two services, one at 9 o'clock and one at 11 o'clock. And what I really want to just ask you to do is three main things as we prepare and we get ready for that, okay? We can't do it. I can't do it by myself. Like, we need to do this together, like all hands on deck. Why? Because we want to make more space for more people to experience the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? So I want to ask you to do these three things. Number one is pray. In your times of prayer this week, I just want to ask you to make the launching of our second service on that February 2nd a matter of prayer. Why? Because we should be doing everything in response to prayer. Prayer should undergird every ministry. Everything that we do, every decision that we make, prayer should undergird all of that. In fact, the week before February 2nd, we're going to be sending out 25,000 mailers. Okay, to 25,000 of the closest people around the church. Okay, and what I wanted you to do is pray that as people check their mail and they see that mailbox, they see that beautiful mailer that we're going to be sending out, that the Holy Spirit will prick their hearts and touch them and say, yeah, I need a church family. I need a church home, and I think I'm going to go try this place out. Wouldn't it be amazing to see God move in a powerful way and change lives as we participate in prayer? Amen? So I want you to pray with me that God moves powerfully through that mailer and through our services on February the 2nd and beyond. The second thing I want you to do is consider serving. If you already are serving, I just want to say thank you so much for doing that. It's so important that our dream team is active and we're growing and we're a part of what God is doing here at this church. So thank you so much. If you clean the bathrooms during the week, boy, it's a thankless job and it's behind the scenes and nobody really sees it much, but I see it and God sees it, and I want to say thank you. If you're here today and you're not serving and you're like, boy, I would love to have more information, I would love to begin serving, that is awesome. I want you to make plans to attend the growth track coming up. That's your pathway to begin serving, okay? And we want to encourage everyone, as we go to those two services, serve one and attend one. Boy, if everybody would do that, we would have plenty of help. If what's that quote that says, like, many hands make light work, right? If we're all involved, if we're all engaged in one way or another, it's a beautiful thing. And my friends, that's the way the church is supposed to be. We're a body. We're a family. Everybody has their own part. And so I want to encourage you to make serving a priority. And the third thing is this. I want you to invite people. Think about your friends, your family, your neighbors, your coworkers, people that you interact with on a daily basis. Will you invite them to church with you on that day? Will you do those things? Will you pray? Will you serve? Will you invite? And we're going to watch God move in a powerful way this year through the Springs Church. Amen? Yeah. Amen. Come on, let's give Him praise. I want to start off with a statement, and this is up on the screen. It says this: 2020, this year can be the best year of your life if, everybody say if, yeah. If it is your best year spiritually. Think about your relationship with God. Think about your family. Think about your spiritual journey. Are you making God a priority? I believe that you are because you're here today. Amen? You're here today and you're like, I'm going to make 2020 the best year of my life because I am putting God first in all things. Let me ask you a series of questions. Are you willing to grow spiritually this year? Are you willing to leave your past behind and embrace all those things that God has in store for you this year? And are you willing to go all in with God, like holding nothing back, not stiff-arming Him in this area or closing the door on Him in this area? I mean, opening up your heart full on and saying, God, this year I'm giving you everything. If you will do that, and if you will be honest with Him, and you will just say, God, I'm going to put you first. My friends, this year can be absolutely the best year of your life. Are you willing to do that? I like to make a challenge at the beginning of the year a lot of times, and I just call it the go all in for 12 months challenge and see what God will do. Okay? So if you're here and you're looking for a home church, you're just checking us out, we're glad that you're here, but I want to invite you and just give you this challenge. Man, for the next 12 months, would you commit to just plug in? Like, do everything that we have going on. Make church attendance a priority. Attend that growth track. Join a life group. Serve on the dream team. Just make a commitment to do that this year and engage and connect in what God is doing here and see if God doesn't transform your life for the better this year. My friends, if He doesn't, I would encourage you to go to a different church and I'll go with you. So today, as we continue with a new year and new you, I want to talk to you specifically about the person and work of the Holy Spirit. Would you say that with me? The person and work of the Holy Spirit. I want to talk to you about how He can make all the difference in your life as you move into the rest of this year and beyond. The Holy Spirit can do powerful things through and in a person's life. Yesterday, I was really reflecting because we've been in ministry now in Las Vegas for 5 years, as Pastor Rory has said. And I was just reflecting upon that journey and thinking about all the things that we've been through, all the ups, all the downs, all the joys, all the hardships that we've faced along the way. And if you don't know our story, just a little bit up front here, Ashley and I received a call from God during a time of prayer and fasting at our church in Tennessee. And we heard God say and put in our spirit the name of the city, Las Vegas. And we didn't know anything about the city, and we were scared to death. I mean, all we knew of the city was what? Hotels, shows, restaurants, all this kind of stuff. We had no idea that there were actual people that live here. We would tell people after God confirmed it, and they were like, where are you going to live? You're going to live in the Bellagio? Like, we don't think there are actual neighborhoods and schools and churches and communities and grocery stores and all these things. All we knew about Vegas, we got from the movies, right? And so we had a lot to learn during that time, but we prayed, and God gave us confirmation after confirmation where it just became so clear to us that if we did not obey and move our family from Tennessee to Las Vegas, we would just be in disobedience. I mean, it was that clear to us. And so we moved to town during the summer of 2014. When we got here, I worked a part-time job at U-Haul. Boy, it was during the summer. And I was cleaning out trucks, driving from here to there, helping people move. But on the church end, we started to blow up social media, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, all these things. And we would promote, hey, we're moving to town and we have a vision to start a new church. And we would promote that and we would say, if we secured Red Rock Lanes. There was a meeting place there at the bowling alley. And we said, if you would come and you would let us speak to you for about 30 minutes, we want to invest in you and your family, and we're going to give you a free game of bowling, okay? It was holy bribery, okay? And so we promoted that, and a lot of people would come, and we would just share our hearts. Ashley and I would. We would share our hearts with them. We would say, God has called us to come here, and we need a team of people. And so we want to invite you to consider just committing with us for the next few months and help us to launch this church. And so we did that. We held what we called interest meetings at the bowling alley at Red Rock Lanes. That's where it all started. We built a team of 35 people to serve as our very first dream team. We secured Shadow Ridge High School as our place to meet. It's way up in the, you guys know where Shadow Ridge is? It's way up there. If you go any further, you're in the middle of nowhere. But we secured that place as our place to meet, and we've opened our doors the very first time on Sunday, January 11th, 2015. And throughout these 5 years, just looking back, we experienced all kinds of joys. We saw people's lives change. We saw people be baptized and marriages healed and bodies healed and all kinds of things that God was doing. But we also went through hard times too. Times where we didn't know what to do or what decision to make. During those times, it's when you really learn who God is. You really learn His character. You really see His faithfulness. You really sense the nearness of His love when you're going through the most difficult times of your journey. But week after week, month after month, and year after year, God would demonstrate His great love for us, and He would constantly bring encouragement into our lives. How many of you know? Maybe you don't know, but being a pastor can be difficult and discouraging. But we saw God show up in miraculous ways, and even everyday ways. And it would take me all day to describe, but I was thinking about it yesterday, and I thought to myself, if there was one thing that was just the most profound lesson to me, if I learned one thing during these last 5 years, what was it? And I came up with this, and I put this up on the screen. It's that God's will is accomplished not by might nor by power, but by His Spirit. It was not by human ingenuity or human power of some kind. It's exactly what the prophet Zechariah said. It's not by might nor by power, but it's by My Spirit, says the Lord Almighty. It's by His Spirit. His Spirit is the one who encourages us. His Spirit is the one who guides us and directs us. His Spirit is the one who comforts us and strengthens us in the most difficult times. It's His Spirit. And as we go through life, and as we have things that we want to accomplish in life, and as we desire to make changes in our life, maybe in this new year, and we desire to grow spiritually, and we desire to pursue God's will for our lives this year and beyond. We all desire to make a difference in this world, to make our lives count in some way. And I put this up on the screen. Jot this down if you're taking notes with me. God's will is accomplished through your life as you learn. Just hold on right there. As you learn to be a perfect Christian, as you learn to have it all together, God's will be accomplished through your life as you have all the answers and you have it all planned out in your 5-year, your 10-year, your 30-year life goal plan. Right? But here's the truth. God's will is accomplished in and through your life. This is the truth of it. As you learn to depend upon the person and work of the Holy Spirit. As you learn to depend, to lean on, to rely upon the person and work of the Holy Spirit in your life. So for the next few minutes, and really for the next few weeks, I want to just take some time to dive into this. Who is the Holy Spirit? What is His function in our lives? And how can we experience Him more fully in this year and beyond? So I want to start. I'm going to give you lots of notes and scriptures today. So if you go ahead and get your pen and your notepad ready, because I want you to just dive into this with me. I want to invite you into this with me. Number one is this. The Holy Spirit is a person. The Holy Spirit is a person. He's not an ambivalent, impersonal force. The Holy Spirit's presence is not defined as a state of heightened emotion or excitement. Neither is the Holy Spirit some force that's flowing in and through all of everything like in Star Wars, okay? Many of us get our concept of who the Holy Spirit is by way of Hollywood. But we need to understand that the truth of this is found in the Scripture, not in the movies that we see. The Holy Spirit is a person. He is a personal being, not an impersonal thing. So when you think about the Holy Spirit, it's He, not it. The Holy Spirit is a person. And throughout the pages of Scripture, we see that the Holy Spirit has all the attributes of a person. He has a mind. He has a will. He has emotions. I mean, He can be grieved. He can be quenched. He can speak. He can listen. He can make decisions. And the Holy Spirit came to reside inside the believers of Jesus Christ after Jesus rose from the dead and ascended to heaven. And in John chapter 14, Jesus says something powerful to His apostles. It'll be up on the screen. Jesus says this, "I will ask the Father, and He will give you another Helper." Everybody say, helper. We need help in our walk with God. We need help to overcome things. We need help to be victorious in this life. We need help to make a difference in the lives of other people. We cannot do it alone. And He says, He will give you another helper that He may be with you forever. And who is this helper? He is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it does not behold Him or know Him. But you know Him because, look, He abides with you and will be in you. He is our helper. He is our comforter. He is the one, He is our advocate. He is our intercessor. He is our counselor, our strengthener, the one who has been called alongside of us. The Holy Spirit is a person. Number two, jot this down. The Holy Spirit is the third person in the Trinity. He is an equal person in every way with God the Father, God the Son. He is the third member of the Godhead. And Jesus said this to his apostles in Matthew 28. He said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them." Now look, all of these names are together, right? "In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit." God is three in one. In 2 Corinthians chapter 13, the Apostle Paul said this. He said, "May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all." Do you see each member of the Trinity there in that one verse? The grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the precious fellowship or friendship of the Holy Spirit. God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all the divine attributes ascribed to the Father and to the Son are equally ascribed to the Holy Spirit. Number three is this. The Holy Spirit regenerates and indwells those who confess Jesus as Lord and believe in their heart that God raised him from the dead. As a person trusts in the Lord Jesus by faith and as they repent of their sins, something amazing happens. Boy, it happened to me when I was 17 years old and I went into a small country church in Tennessee and I heard the gospel and I understood it for the first time. Did it take too long for it to happen? No. Once I said, "Jesus is Lord," and I believed in my heart that he had been raised from the dead, instantly I became a new person. Instantly I was regenerated by the power of the Holy Spirit. And instantly, God, in the person of the Holy Spirit, took up residence inside of me. He regenerates and indwells the believer. That's why we celebrate when someone is baptized. And we often quote this verse from 1 Corinthians 5:17, where it says, "When someone becomes a Christian, he becomes a brand new person inside. He is not the same anymore. A new life has begun." And now God himself, God of the universe, the God of all power, the God who spoke and things were created, now lives inside of that person. Look at what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. "All of you surely know that you are God's temple." You are God's temple, and that his Spirit lives where? In you. Number four is this. The Holy Spirit is the believer's teacher and guide. The Holy Spirit is the believer's teacher and guide. I'm going to go real slow through here because I believe somebody may be in here and you need to be taught what is true. And you've been questioning, how can I know that this is true? How do I know that Christianity, that Jesus is the way and the truth and the life? The only way that you're going to know that is because the Holy Spirit is going to teach you. That's how you become persuaded. That's how you become convinced. It's not because of a human word, of human words, of a pastor coming up here and talking. No, the Holy Spirit is teaching. The Holy Spirit is guiding into all truth. Look at what it says in John 14, verse 26. But the counselor, The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything that I have said to you. It's the work of the Holy Spirit to teach you and to guide you into truth. It is the work of the Holy Spirit that will bring truth back to your remembrance. 1 John chapter 2, verse 27 says this, "But you have received the Holy Spirit, and He lives within you, so you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know." The Spirit is our teacher and our guide. In John chapter 16, verse 13, it says, "But when He, the Spirit of truth, comes, He will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on His own. He will speak only what He hears." Who's He hearing from? The Father. "He will speak only what He hears, and He will tell you what is to come." He is your guide. He knows what's ahead. And He will let you know things that you need to know in order to be victorious and to walk out His will in your life. So He is the teacher. He is the guide. Number five is this. The Holy Spirit produces Christ-like character in the believer. He produces Christ-like character in the believer in a way that we cannot do on our own. The Holy Spirit builds into us godly character and good fruit. Rather than trying really hard to be loving or patient or good or gentle, it's the Holy Spirit who produces these things in our lives. Look at Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. It says, "But the fruit of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." And Paul goes on to say, "Since we live by the Spirit, let us also keep in step with the Spirit." It is the Holy Spirit who is doing His work inside of you. You don't have to do this on your own. If you want to change, you want to have changes in your life this year and beyond, who do you need to rely on? The Holy Spirit to produce the fruit that you need. Number five is this. The Holy Spirit empowers the believer for effective service. The Holy Spirit is the one who empowers us. He strengthens us. He supernaturally enables us to do God's will in an effective way. Look at Acts chapter 1, verse 5 and 8. It says this, "For John baptized with water, but Jesus said this, 'In a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit.'" And then jump down in verse 8, it says, "But you will receive power." You will receive power when? When the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And you will be my witnesses. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, when you are baptized, immersed, or filled with the Holy Spirit, you receive the supernatural enablement of God to do His will, to point people to Jesus, not to get goosebumps, not to draw attention to yourself, no. But this is so that we can be effective ministers. Did you know that if you're a believer, you are called into the ministry? Maybe not the same type that I am, but you are called into the ministry, and you cannot do it on your own. You have to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. It is God's will. It is His commandment that each believer be baptized, be fully immersed, be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. There's been some confusion about this, but I want to encourage all of you guys, if you think something else, if you believe something else, look this up for yourself. Don't take my word for it. Anytime I'm speaking something or teaching something, I want you to do your own homework. Go search it out and make sure that Pastor Brian is on point. And if I'm not, hey, let's talk about it. But I believe that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not the same experience as being born again or coming into salvation. Rather, the baptism with the Holy Spirit is a second experience of grace. It is an empowerment experience that takes place in the life of the Christian. We are to be immersed in the Spirit's life and in His power. Look at what it says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. Paul said this to the church there. He said, don't get drunk with wine. That leads to wild living. Instead, here's what I want you to do. I want you to be filled. I want you to be constantly filled over and over again with the Holy Spirit. This infilling of power can take place right after you come into salvation. Right after you confess Jesus as Lord and you believe in your heart that He was raised on that third day. It's the baptism with the Holy Spirit can happen right then. And commonly it happens sometime after the salvation experience, if you read through the book of Acts. And commonly, this baptism with the Holy Spirit will result in a person speaking in different kinds of languages or speaking in tongues, or some people call it speaking in your spiritual language. And at that moment, God will disperse that gift. And these gifts, listen, they're not scary, and they're not of the devil. Listen to me. Maybe you have preconceived notions about this, but the Bible is clear. Every gift from God is good, and it should be received with joy. And commonly, as you read through the Scripture, it says people were baptized with the Spirit, or they were filled with the Spirit. They experienced the speaking in other tongues. Not every single time, but commonly, normally, or some other spiritual gift was given to them at that time. These gifts are to be received with joy and used to strengthen yourself in your faith and to lovingly serve the body of Christ. Is this making any sense? Okay. And number six, this is the last one. I want you to jot it down if you're taking notes with me. Come on up here, Star. Thank you. Number six is this. The Holy Spirit is the believer's closest friend. The Holy Spirit is the believer's closest friend. In 2 Corinthians 13, the Message paraphrase says it like this: the amazing grace of the Master, Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God, and the intimate friendship of the Holy Spirit, Paul said, be with you all. That was the apostles' prayer for the body of Christ. And my prayer for us is that we be a people who do not stiff arm or ignore the power and the person of the Holy Spirit, but that we would be a church that embraces His move. That we would be a church that says, no, I'm not interested in the bathwater, but give me the baby. I want the real thing. I want the real, genuine, power of the Holy Spirit to move in my life and in our church. My friends, this is the only way for the church to be effective in our mission. We have to learn more fully. I have to learn more fully how to depend upon the person and work of the Holy Spirit to accomplish God's will. You see, when we stop learning about the Holy Spirit and we begin to know Him, to fellowship with Him, to develop a friendship with Him, our lives will never be the same. Instead of trying to add His power to our lives, we will learn that what we need to do is surrender to Him. Surrender to His love. Surrender to His will. Surrender to His direction. You see, if the Holy Spirit is a power, we'll want to get a hold of it. Right? But if the Holy Spirit is a person, we will want Him to get a hold of us. If the Holy Spirit is a power, we will want it in order to accomplish our will. But if the Holy Spirit is a divine person, we will want to surrender more to Him in awe and wonder. If the Holy Spirit is a power, we'll be proud that we have it. And we'll feel superior to those who do not. If the Holy Spirit is a person, then we will be humbled that in His great love, the very third person of the Trinity has chosen to live inside of us. Three application points, and then we're going to have a time of prayer together. Number one is this. As you go into your new year, new you, number one application point is this. Let go of any fears or misperceptions that you may have about the Holy Spirit, about who He is or about His work in the world. Let go of those things. Number two is go all in with God. Go all in. Hold absolutely nothing back. And you will see God transform your life, and He will use your life to impact the lives of others around you. And number three is this. Develop that intimate friendship with Him. Develop that fellowship with the Spirit this year.